If you were food shopping for your family, which one of our hidden foods would you choose? The first one's ingredients include ground yellow corn, soybean meal, corn gluten, wheat middlings, and so forth. Our second one includes rice, sugar, marshmallows, corn syrup, and dextrose. Stay with me, and I'll tell you what these hidden foods are in a moment. Welcome to Cooking by the Book. I'm Marcella Lynch, and I've invited you into my kitchen to take a look at an exciting kind of cooking from a very old book. By the way, in just a few minutes, I'll be telling you what hidden foods are in those bags I showed you. I grew up as a country girl in Oregon in an old house with an old barn, gardening, canning, and freezing fruits and vegetables, doing everything from scratch. I have fond memories of my mother's simple, good cooking. She cooked by the old book, too, as did her mother before her. Because I enjoyed my country home life so much, and because my family adhered devotedly to this old book, I early decided to become a home economics teacher, which I am today, and have spent years and years teaching teenagers and adults to cook by, you guessed it, this old book. Now, you need to know a little more of the story. The old proverb, necessity is the mother of invention, came true for me. When I grew up and married, I was uprooted from the country and have lived in the San Francisco area for almost 30 years. You know, you can get the girl out of the country, but you can't get the country out of the girl. So I began to explore ways to live the fast pace of a city person and still adhere to the principles of the old book. And that is what this series of 13 cooking lessons is all about. Cooking from scratch with the old-fashioned real foods, but not taking all day to do it, as grandmother used to do. I become what I call a shortcut cook, using whole natural foods, but incorporating time-saving secrets. This series of lessons is a basic cooking course for natural food beginner cooks, which will include these topics. Each lesson will demonstrate cooking techniques for healthy cooking, as well as nutrition principles for bringing God's original diet into your home. For this old book, as you may have guessed, is the Bible. You may not have known that through its pages you can learn how to eat to prevent disease, to prolong life, and to feel vibrant. Two things to remember as you watch the videos. First of all, you'll want a notepad and pencil to take a few notes. Secondly, key recipes will appear in print at the end of each lesson so you can copy them down if you miss them. Here in this old ancient book, we read, "Beloved, I wish above all things that you may prosper and be in health. If you have tried to make a change to a more healthful diet, but found it too difficult, too time-consuming, or the food tasted terrible, then you'll want to keep watching. You will be given elementary level recipes, menus, and nutrition concepts that will help you build low-fat, low-cholesterol vegetarian meals that are not only good tasting, but good for you." The typical kitchen cupboard of today's modern way of life usually looks something like this: white flour and white sugar, shortening, salt, baking powder, soda, chocolate, white flour pancake and cake mixes, condiments and spices, relishes, pickles, sugar-frosted cereals and flakes, deep-fried and salted chips and crackers, and sugared-down snack foods, Wonder Breads, jams and jellies, ketchup and mustard, meat, butter, cream, and soft drinks galore. This is what you could call engineered food. Food that is manufactured by food chemists and technicians. Vital nutrients and fiber are often removed. Does it really matter how I eat, when I eat, and what I eat? What is healthy cooking anyway? Dr. Jean Meyer, president of Tufts University and former professor of nutrition at Harvard University, has said that diet is the single most important environmental factor affecting our health. My dentist friend is often dismayed by what he finds in the mouths of his young patients. Boys and girls are not old enough to enter school, but suffer rampant tooth decay, and they are not from poverty-stricken homes. Their parents have ample funds to supply all the necessities. The children are malnourished in the midst of plenty. How strange. One dentist's answer to this problem, although drastic, has often proved effective. He asks the parents, "Would you like your son's teeth to be strong and healthy?" "Oh, certainly we would," they reply. "What would we have to do?" "Do you have a dog or other pet?" the dentist asks. "Why, yes, we have a small poodle," they answer. "Why?" "Well, tomorrow," says the dentist, "begin feeding your dog whatever you have been feeding your son, and let your son eat what you have been buying for the poodle. In a few months, all the holes will be in the dog's teeth, and your son will be in great shape." Of course, this is all for the shock value. Many parents get the point and begin thinking seriously about the family diet. They have seen the list of nutrients on the dog food can, and they suddenly realize that they have been more concerned about their pet's physical welfare than their children's. And by the way, let's see which food product you selected at the beginning of our lesson. If you selected the ingredients in this bag, you chose a popular breakfast cereal. In the other bag, we find a popular cat food. Now, we don't want you to go out and start buying cat food for your family, but we do want to encourage you to be a label reader in order to feed your family healthy foods. You are what you eat. It does matter what you eat. So, what constitutes a good diet? In order to know what the best foods are, we must study God's original plan. He who created humans and who understands our needs appointed Adam his food. The record reads that God said, "I have provided all kinds of grain and all kinds of fruit for you to eat." Grains, fruits, nuts, and vegetables constitute the diet chosen for us by our Creator. These foods, prepared in as simple and natural a manner as possible, are the most healthful and nourishing. They impart a strength, a power of endurance, and a vigor of intellect that are not afforded by a more complex diet. The best diet doctor I have found is our all-wise and loving Creator, who provides in nature the very best nourishment for us all. Nutritious food is the special fuel for our body machines. Each type of engine runs on its own special fuel. Some of us try to feed our engine unfit fuel, too greasy, too sweet, too fluffy, and too rich, and our machines cough and sputter and break down and wear out too soon. God is as truly the author of physical laws as He is the author of the moral law. His law is written with His own finger upon every nerve, every muscle, and every faculty which has been entrusted to man. All should have an intelligent knowledge of the human frame that they may keep their bodies in the condition necessary to do the work of the Lord. Cooking by the book means becoming your own manufacturer, turning wholesome grains, beans, fruits, and vegetables into tasty, nourishing dishes. It means using foods in their whole original state, no edible parts discarded, and no hurtful refined ingredients added. To begin our Cooking by the Book series, I'd like to take you for a walk through a natural food kitchen. Let's take a look at the staples found in a natural food kitchen. First of all, legumes, or beans as they are commonly called, are a natural food cook's main dish standby. How should beans be stored? Dry beans keep well at room temperature for months. Simply store them in airtight jars or other see-through containers using tight-fitting lids. We want to keep the moisture and the bugs out and lock their freshness in. At my house, I use these see-through containers so I can quickly find what I am after and spot what ingredients I need to restock. Keep on hand a pound or so of different kinds of beans. You will meet the legume family of beans and how to cook them in lesson 6. A small supply of canned beans is handy also to have when you need an easy main dish in a hurry. I especially like to use canned garbanzos, kidney beans, and pinto beans for salads, mashing for spreads, and for refried beans and in soups. Secondly, grains are one staple that differs in the kitchen of a natural food cook. Instead of white flour and white sugar products, the natural food kitchen uses whole grain products. They're heartier, they carry more nutrients, and definitely more flavor. There are several ways to go with bringing whole grains into your kitchen. Once you are fully into the whole grain way of cooking, you may purchase a flour mill and a food processor to mill your own fresh flours and cereals. At first, as you get acquainted with whole wheat flour and breads and whole grain cereals, you may purchase your ingredients ready-milled from a market with a natural food section, or you may purchase breads ready-made from a whole grain bakery. Whichever way you go, whole grains and whole grain products need to be stored airtight and in a cool place. Bugs are smarter than people. They love the flavor and nutrition of these whole grains in the cupboard. White flour and white sugar products can sit on your shelf uninfested for months. But because whole natural grains taste better and contain the life and nourishment of the grain, invisible bug eggs, which most likely came on the grains or the flour all the way from the field, can hatch out in your warm kitchen cupboard and invade your whole domain. Little bugs become moths and can move through your other foods, chewing their way from plastic bag to plastic bag. Storing whole grains, flours, and cereals in airtight containers will prevent the bug problems from moving past the first container. Grains store best if kept whole, and they are cheaper to purchase whole. God designed them with a covering that locks in their freshness and their nutrients. Grains in their whole state keep nicely for months and years in airtight containers at room temperatures. They lose no nutrients, no freshness, and till they're cracked open or ground into flour, which exposes then the inside portion of the kernel. If you purchase cereals and whole grains ready ground into flour, do keep them airtight and as cool as possible so the natural oils will not deteriorate the products and bugs will not infest. Refrigeration or freezing is ideal for the flours, whole grain flours. Plan to purchase smaller amounts and replenish your supply more often if necessary. And label each jar of grain by name for easy identification. Then at a moment's notice, you can open them up and use them to make flour, breakfast cereals, and all your baking needs. Now keep watching. You will learn how to turn these whole grains into flours, cereals, and delicious dishes in the following lessons. Fruits and vegetables are used in abundance by the natural food cook. As many fresh as possible, supplemented with canned, frozen, and dried. Fresh fruits and vegetables need cold storage, but not freezing. Root vegetables, such as potatoes and winter squash and onions, may be stored in sacks or boxes in any cool, dark, frost-proof place. A winter temperature of 35 to 40 degrees is desirable for the best results. Nuts and seeds are excellent concentrated sources for protein, fat, and other nutrients. A little goes a long way. Shelled nuts and seeds contain fragile oils, which become rancid at room temperatures. Nuts and seeds keep well in the shell, but once shelled, require refrigeration, freezing, or vacuum sealing. The seasonings and flavorings in my kitchen are probably different from yours in some ways and similar in others. Most cooks rely on meat juices and fats for flavoring their main dishes. I use fresh and dried herbs generously, such as sweet basil, thyme, sage, dillweed, oregano, cumin, and many others. These are the backbone of flavoring vegetables and meatless entrees. I do not use the known irritating spices and condiments such as black and white pepper family, mustard, curry powder, cloves, nutmeg, vinegar, pickles, and ketchups. In our cookbook, Cooking by the Book, you will find recipes for homemade, non-irritating curry powder, chili powder, chicken-style seasoning, and seasoning salts, as well as a list of which spices are considered irritating to the body. Other miscellaneous staples used in the kitchen of a natural food cook include vegetable oils, tofu, plain yogurt, non-fat dairy products, honey, date sugar, thickening agents, and so forth. Now, don't feel that you have to run out to the grocery store and purchase the entire natural food lineup of staples in order to get started. Bring them into your kitchen gradually as your recipes and menus call for them. There are a few tricks to saving time in the natural food kitchen as you cook with whole natural foods instead of grabbing ready-prepared packaged mixes out of the supermarket. Trick number one is to organize your kitchen. Store food and equipment at the place in the kitchen where it will be first used. For example, you want to store your pots and pans near the stove. And you want to store your dish towels near the sink, and food staples such as your grains, beans, seasonings, and flavorings, measuring cups and spoons at the mixing center. Set aside a certain area of your kitchen for a mixing center. At this center, you will store your basic ingredients used in baking, such as your grains and beans, along with your measuring utensils, any kitchen mixer, blender, or flour mills that you may have. Instead of running back and forth from one end of the kitchen to the other, you can stand in one spot to mix and prepare any entire recipe. You are now on your way to becoming a true natural food shortcut cook. Trick number two is to organize your food staples. As we have already seen, grains and beans are conveniently stored in uniformly labeled jars or other containers for easy access and visibility. It's much faster to find the ingredients if they are stored in an organized and uniform manner. It is of utmost importance to make all ingredients easy to find, easy to open, and individually labeled. Trick number three is to organize your work. Plan a specific time each week to sit down for 20 minutes and sketch out menus for the week. Don't walk into your kitchen a half an hour before mealtime and say, "Let's see now, what shall we have for dinner?" If you neglect to plan meals in advance, you will fall back into eating packaged fast food meals, which are more expensive, higher in fat, cholesterol, and sodium, and lacking in fiber. If you are a working person, you may dash out to a fast food restaurant instead. Planning menus in advance is an important key to sticking to a wholesome eating plan. Try the one-week menu planner found in the Cooking by the Book cookbook. Natural cooking is not difficult, just different. Planning ahead will help you remember to do such jobs as cooking rice, beans, or potatoes in the morning for use at the evening meal. By writing out your menus in advance, your meals will become more interesting and contain wider variety of good foods throughout the week and the month. Trick number four to organize your work is to keep a grocery list going at all times, to save trips to the grocery store for forgotten items. Trick number five is to shop for groceries just once per week. Don't depend on your memory. Don't shop every day. Shopping once a week with the written list in hand will save impulse buying of junk foods, as well as saving money on your food budget. Now, I'm going to show you today a simple dinner meal that is one of my favorites. Our menu is savory black beans over steamed brown rice, spinach salad with yogurt herb dressing, whole grain bread with a spread, and layered applesauce dessert. Let's just go briefly through the recipes. We will be explaining these in greater detail in future classes. Basic cooking of a pot of brown rice is simply 2 parts water to 1 part brown rice. Bring 2 cups of water to a boil with 1/4 to 1/2 teaspoon salt. Add 1 cup of raw brown rice. Reduce heat to low, cover, and cook on low heat for 45 minutes. Don't stir, don't peek. You serve that with black beans. Bean cookery will be covered thoroughly in a future class. Here's our recipe for savory black beans. 1 pound black beans, 1 large onion chopped, 2 bell peppers chopped, 1 clove of garlic minced, 1/4 cup olive oil, 1 bay leaf, 1 to 2 teaspoons of salt, and 1 pound of cooked brown rice. Wash the 1 pound of black beans and cook with the 6 cups of water for 1 hour. Braise the onions, the bell pepper, and garlic. Combine all ingredients, cook them until they're tender, and serve over brown rice. Garnish with a dollop of plain yogurt and chopped green onions. This recipe serves 10 people. Now our dessert is a quickie, layered applesauce served in sherbet glasses. Alternate layers of chilled applesauce, granola, and whipped topping in a stemware glass. Garnish with a twisted orange slice and sprig of fresh mint. So simple and easy, and best of all, low in sugar. Here you have it, our complete meal. Black beans over steamed brown rice, spinach salad with yogurt herb dressing, and whole grain bread with layered applesauce dessert. Cooking by the Book recommends carbohydrate or starch-based meals rather than meat or protein-based meals. Planning your meal around potatoes or rice accompanied by beans or tofu or nuts is a carbohydrate-based meal. It also contains plenty of adequate protein, minerals, vitamins, and fiber without a formal meat dish. Did you know there are more vegetarians in the world than meat eaters? It is easy to prepare adequate meals without meat. I've been a vegetarian since birth, and we have raised our children on a vegetarian diet. What is a vegetarian diet? It's a meatless diet. There are several kinds of vegetarians. A pure vegetarian or vegan eats only plant foods. A lacto-ovo vegetarian uses products from animals, milk, and eggs, but no meat, poultry, or fish. Why do people choose to be vegetarians? There are a variety of reasons, all good reasons. First, economy, to save money on the food bill. Second, ecological. It takes 1/4 of an acre to feed a vegetarian for a year versus 3 acres to feed a meat eater. Third, humanitarian. Taking of animal life is wrong and not a necessity. Fourth, religious. Some religions consider animals sacred. And fifth, health. For many people, preventing disease through diet is the number one goal. In summary, cooking by the book means cooking by God's ideal diet. It concentrates on whole, live foods prepared in simple, tasty, attractive ways. It presents the eating guidelines of Seventh-day Adventists, who have long been recognized in scientific circles for their exceptional health and for following God's biblical diet. Various studies have long indicated that Adventists are not afflicted as often with the killer diseases of our society, coronary artery diseases, cancer, and diseases of the respiratory system. Such diseases are much lower than the national average in those Adventists who follow the health teachings of their church. The Seventh-day Adventist diet is a lacto-ovo vegetarian diet, by and large, with limited use of dairy products and eggs. Getting acquainted with natural food staples and organizing your kitchen and your meal planning are the first steps to cooking by the book. One caution, as you begin, Don't move through your kitchen like a tornado and throw out all your refined foods at once. Make the change gradually. And keep in mind that we first eat with our eyes. Make the food look attractive and appealing. And do remember to thank God for providing it.
Recipes shown in this program are available in Marcella Lynch's companion cookbook, Cooking by the Book. This 315-page cookbook is filled with healthful plant-based recipes and meal ideas that are delicious and easy to make. These low-fat, low-cholesterol dishes will help your family get a balanced diet that promotes better health. To order Cooking by the Book, call 1-800-655-9071. Or you may email to lynchmarcella@gmail.com.